Okay, let's do some classical problems on synchronization. Let's solve them using semaphores. And the first one is the bounded buffer problem, also known as the producer-consumer problem, where we have this environment, and in that environment, producer puts an item. Items on this shared buffer and consumer removes items from this shared buffer. So how to implement this framework? So consider the following. First of all, the producer shouldn't produce any item if the buffer is already full. So I will control that using a semaphore called full. Okay, so I will use three different semaphores. Also, consumer shouldn't consume anything if the buffer is empty. So I will check the emptiness using empty semaphore, a semaphore called empty. And since there is some shared entity around, which is the buffer in this case, I need a mutual exclusion that will make me write and read stuff to this shared buffer in a mutually exclusive manner. So I can suggest the following code to you. Let's go over the solution, then discuss if you have some arguments with it. So the producer will first look at the empty situation. So remember, empty. Initially, the buffer is not empty. Okay, so the empty value is the size of the buffer, so it is not zero. So the semaphores, when they become negative, they will block the system, block the process or thread, not the whole system. So starting empty with a high value like n, there is no danger of producer getting blocked because everything is empty initially. So it will escape from here, but it will make empty equal to n minus 1. Then, since I will produce something, I will write something to the shared global buffer array. So I will enable the mutex and do the writing, and I will then signal that mutex so that others can do updates on this buffer. Okay, so the mutex are easier to understand. Mutex statements are easier to understand here. So await, then the critical section, and then the signal of the corresponding mutex. The more interesting part is on the empty and full maintenance. So when the producer puts something to the buffer, now I increase the full to 1. Okay, initially there is nothing in the buffer, so I now start to signal it, like increase the value. But assume that at this time, okay, so I am maybe here after the signal mutex, some switch occurred, context switch. So now the turn is for the consumer, but the consumer thinks that the buffer is empty, okay? So it calls the wait on full, and full is zero here, so it will cause a blocking because zero minus one is minus one negative, and remember this semaphore function wait. So you will be blocked here. It won't go further. And later on, when this producer thread takes the control again, it will increases the full to one, and it is over, and it will then continue. But now, when the turn comes to the consumer, it will see the full as a non-zero value, like one. So it will make it zero because now I am about to consume it. So one becomes zero again, but it won't keep me here blocked. I will continue. And now, in a mutually exclusive manner, I update the buffer. So what is the signal empty then? I am, since I consumed one more item. Now there is one more emptiness in my buffer array. So I increase the empty in case someone is waiting on that empty. Okay, just in case. So this is the mechanism. Another popular synchronization problem is about reading and writing, reader and writer problem. So there is some shared data here. In this case, a shared file maybe. So multiple readers can read it at the same time, no problem. However, the writer writing is more critical. So I allow only one writer in the system. So if there is one writer that is about to write, then I allow neither another writer nor another reader to enter the system, to enter that region. So let's implement this problem now. Let's solve this problem. So in other words, allow multiple readers to read at the same time. Okay, no problem. But only one single writer can access the shared data at the same time. Yeah, at the same time, only single writer. So no reader or writer when a writer is active. So again, now I will keep the number of readers reading the data at the moment. This is important because the first reader or the last reader will do something special. So I will detect it using this variable. And also, since this variable will be updated by many threads, I need some mutual exclusion here, which is initially allowed, like one. And also there is this write semaphore that will enable only one writer in the region at any given time. So the writer process is extremely easy. Basically, if you are allowed to write, and initially, where are my initializations here? Did I show it? Yeah, write is initially one. So initially, you can just write. One becomes zero, so I am writing, and when I quit, I make write one again. Okay, so if the writer is writing, so WRT becomes zero, another writer comes, it just waits here, because WRT becomes minus one. But now the more interesting part is on the reader, because it needs to handle all the other remaining issues. So first of all, I am a reader. I come in. I am definitely increase the reader count. Okay. And if reader count becomes one, meaning that I am the first reader, so it means something. So I need to do something special about the first reader. What is that special thing? I will wait on the write. So if there is already a writer inside, then I will just block here, because by definition, if the writer is already active, then readers can't be active. So although I increase read count, no problem. I will just stay here. I won't perform the reading here. But if there is no writer, then I escape from here. I cancel my mutex and I am doing the reading. But be careful, I already flagged the write to zero, so that when the reading is performed, a writer cannot come in. Okay, assume that the second reader comes, it makes read count two. Since it is not one, I don't nothing special, I don't do extra wait. 3 does nothing, 4 does nothing, 5, etc. So assume that I have 5 readers here, and now one is done. Say the fourth reader is done. So I will update the read count to 4. So again, it means that there are still 4 guys here. Let's move them out as well. 3 reader, 2 reader, 1 reader. So when there is only one reader here, the read count becomes zero here, right? So it means that I am the last reader, meaning that now I need to undo this write action because now there is no one in the system. So the writer may safely come in. So maybe it is already waiting here. Maybe not. I don't care. I just undo this wait action on the write. So write is now one, definitely. So with one here, it will let someone in if a writer comes. Yeah, so these are the wait and signal calls we discussed before. Again, a wait on zero, a wait on a positive number will not block you. It will just decrease that positive number to another positive number or to zero. Even if it is zero, you will not be blocked. But if your semaphore is zero or less, then you will definitely be blocked. And assume that S is minus five now, means that you have five blocks has happened. So when the signal becomes minus five plus one, minus four, you will wake one of the five processes in the first FIFO manner. So minus four means I still have four guys inside, etc. So let's analyze this condition. First reader acquires the lock reading. So I am here. What happens if a writer arrives? As we discussed, writer is blocked because this WRT is zero now. So writer makes it minus one and it just stays here until what? Until signal WRT is called, which will unblock this waiting guy. And it will also convert the WRT value to zero. Okay, first reader gets the lock here, reading. What happens if second reader arrives? No problem, right? First reader gets the lock. It also goes out of mutex. While it is reading, the second can come into the mutex, but it doesn't take any further precautions for the writing. It will also go to the reading directly. What happens if the writer gets the lock? Writing, so I am here. What happens at this time if the reader one arrives? And what happens? Let's see. Reader one makes read count equal to one, which is correct. And since this is the first reader, it will block here because WRT is zero now. It has made zero after this statement. And semaphore zero will cause a block because it will become minus one. So long story short, when there is a writer inside, the reader will not be here. It will just stay here. It will just stay here. And what happens if a second reader comes at this point? So an interesting question, because second reader, you may ask, it won't be affected by this wait because it will be two. But wait a second. The first reader who was in this mutex block hasn't escaped from the mutex, right? So mutex was one before. First reader made it zero. Okay, so mutex is zero now. And later, since first reader is still here, it didn't signal mutex back to one. Later, second reader comes in and it will not be able to pass this statement. It will be locked here. Okay, which makes sense because I don't want it to continue here. It will be locked due to the mutex, not due to the WRT. So this is a perfectly fine implementation then. Another popular problem is this dining philosopher problem, where you need two resources to do something, or two forks. So these are not the process creation forks, by the way, obviously. These are the eating forks. You need two forks to eat. Okay, so I don't know what you are eating here with two forks. So maybe some spaghetti, but even that may get some spoon. But anyway, just consider you need two forks to eat. And we call it philosopher because if you are eating, you are eating. Otherwise, you are just thinking, like doing nothing. That's why there is some little joke about that. So while a philosopher is holding a fork, its neighbor can't have it. So every guy here is a process, and forks are the resources. If process two is having this, then process three cannot have this fork, okay? And consequently, three cannot eat while two is eating. And similarly, one cannot eat while two is eating, but two and zero, they can eat simultaneously because their resources do not overlap. Okay, so here is, maybe that's why they do two forks to get the food, but anyway, so we have two forks here. Again, two and zero, they can eat safely. Now, what is happening here? I forgot the time I took these screenshots, but still it makes sense. Okay, so one and four is eating. Okay, which is fine. And so this picture is just turned out to be funny, in my opinion. So there seems to be a romantic action, but actually they just want to share a resource which is forbidden. So this is an error time, not another time. Now let's implement this. So I want parallelism, like four can eat while two is eating, but one cannot eat while two is eating. I don't want a deadlock. I don't want starvation. So here is my solution to you. Let's discuss this now. So in this solution, what we have is I will have five semaphores because I will have five different resources. So let's also name them as 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so this is resource 0, resource 1, etc. So if the process, so I am, this is the process, philosopher function that is going to, one second.
Alo?
Yok ya, dersliyim özür dilerim. Ha, tamam. Yes, so, so process zero or philosopher zero wants to eat, okay? So it will look at, so zero is this guy, look at fork zero and fork one. Are they both okay? So initially they are one. One means okay. Remember in the semaphore business, when you call wait with zero or less, you will be blocked. But one, no problem. So zero and one, I can get them. I will set them to zero, decrease them by one. Okay, and I will do the eat. And when I am done, I will then up them back. So this fork becomes one again. This fork becomes one again. And by the way, there is this mod 5 here. I am sure you understand it, but this is just for the circular array effect. So it means that if you are philosopher 4, then this is index 4, fork 4. And this is not fork 5, but it is fork 0. So after 4, you come to 0. So you need to have 5 mod 5, which is 0. Okay? So this is the situation, actually. It looks fine to me. So let's analyze it with another configuration, like 1 is eating. Means that fork 1 is halt, and fork 2 is also halt. So I am eating. Now process 2 wants to eat. So process 2 wants to access fork 2, but there is a problem because fork 2 is already 0 now. So it will be minus 1. So it will be in the waiting queue of this particular fork called fork 2. Again, I named the forks from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is the situation, but there is a deadlock problem here. Although this is a fine solution, there is a deadlock problem. How unlucky can you be to get a deadlock? So consider this circular action. So for instance, process 4 gets this fork. Okay. Sorry, gets the left fork maybe. Yeah, left fork. So process 4 gets fork number 4. Then a context switch occurs. Okay, so right at this point, contextivity occurs. So see, I have two weights. After the first weight, contextivity occurs. So I get this fork, and now it is time of P3 to get this fork. It will get it. Then another context switch. It will cause P2 to get this fork, fork 2. Context switch. Process 1 gets the left hand, which is fork 1. Context switch. Process 0 gets the fork 0, which is also fine. And now is the terrible time. Another context switch. So process 4 now wants to get this fork, right? Because it has already got the left hand fork 4. Now it wants to get fork 0. However, fork 0 was held by process 0, philosopher 0. So it will never be able to get it because process 0 will be waiting on this fork, which is currently held by the left hand of the first philosopher. So this is a deadlock. How you can solve it is, a solution can be the following. You put the left back if you can't grab the right. So if you can't grab the second one in the same iteration, you just leave the other one to the table. Or you can get some hardware support, like put these two weights inside an atomic function so that once you do one weight, the context switch will never help keep you from doing the second weight. So they can be uninterruptible. So another problem here is the rendezvous problem, where you want, for instance, A1 happens before B1 and B1 happens before A2. So in other words, you want these two threads to meet at this line. Okay. Okay. So I want, if thread A comes here before the executing A2 statement, it will wait for process B, thread B, to come here to execute B2 statement. Okay, so the line 4 is their rendezvous point. Line 2 is their rendezvous point. So initially, so I want them arrive at the rendezvous line. Line 2 on the above line here. Sorry. So lines are confused here. So I mean, as I told you in the first time, I want them to wait just before the second lines, okay? So you can do it like this. A1 is executed. Then I don't want to continue until B comes, okay? So B arrived will wait you because initially it is 0. So this thread will just wait at this rendezvous point, line 3. Meanwhile, thread B will come here. So B has arrived. So it is safe. So B notifies any other threads waiting. And it will also wait for A to come. So it means that if I am here, it means that both B and A are at this level. So you can still do this by swapping these two functions. But if you do this version, for instance, here is the deadlock configuration, because A1 thread 1 comes, it executes A1, then it waits on B, okay? So it blocks because B is 0 initially. Then thread B comes and it waits on A. So now B is waiting on A and A is waiting on B. So they are both waiting on them indefinitely. So no one will be able to reach line 3. So this is a bad implementation then. Another case of this rendezvous problem is the generalization of the previous part to many threads, like more than two threads, multiple threads. I want to meet at this rendezvous point before going to the critical section. I mean, no thread executes the critical point until after all threads have executed the rendezvous points. So when first n minus one threads arrive, they will block. And when the end thread comes, now all of them are free. They will all enter this region. Okay, so this is like the rendezvous point. So I can solve it like this, for instance. Is this a good solution? So I am in the rendezvous point. Now I will increase my count to one. And again, when count is n, I will proceed to the critical point, okay? So I will increase my count. Since it is a shared global variable, I do it within the mutex semaphores. So if this is the last end thread, then I signal, okay? But before that, assume this is not the end thread, so I just wait here. So thread 0 waits, thread 1 waits, thread 2 waits, thread 3 waits. So currently, barrier semaphore is minus 3, meaning that I have 3 things waiting on me. And assume n is 4, okay? So when n is 4, when the fourth thread comes, this signals only one of them, but I was waiting, three threads were waiting here, okay? So there is a problem in the solution. What you can do is, actually, you can do is this following nice trick. I will put a signal here as well, okay? So what you just obtain is the following. When the fourth thread comes, it will signal, so I will unblock maybe thread number 3, and thread number 3 will unblock another thread because it calls a new signal. Okay, see, I have a second signal. So this will unblock thread number 2, and thread number 2 will unblock another thread because it will call another signal. So thread 1, and thread 1 will signal, so thread 0 will now be safe. Okay, so this is the solution. This is also known as the barrier problem, where you multiple threads meet at this barrier point or rendezvous point. And by the way, so this is the correct solution. Slide 121 is okay. How about the next slide? So there is a problem here. What is the problem? So basically, what I did is I extend the scope of the mutex, okay? But it will cause a deadlock because when the first thread blocks, okay, again, n is 4 or 5, whatever, but initially the first thread comes, count becomes 1. Count is not 4, do nothing, but wait. So this first thread is blocked, okay, it will not proceed, because barrier is initially 0, and as we discussed, when all the others, when the end, the last thread comes, everything will unblock. So the first thread will wait here. So what happens when the second thread comes? It will just stay here forever, because this mutex has not been released yet. Okay, I haven't, the first thread didn't do mutex.signal. So this is a terrible mistake, okay? By just putting the signal two lines below, like to number line number 8 or 9, you will just make things terrible. And actually, this brings me to the last part of this synchronization business, which is the monitors. So you will give the control to the programming language, okay? Because as a programmer, you and me, we can make such mistakes, okay? Just misarrange your weights and signals, etc. So here I will show you more examples. So if you do this signal mutex, so I confuse the order, for instance, first signal, then wait. So you have an unprotected region then. Or you wait on a mutex, like initial value is 1, it became 0, then you wait on it again. Then there will be a deadlock because you forgot to make the signal. So this is the case just happened here, basically. You call wait on mutex twice or more than 2 times. So these are all problematic issues. So I need something else, something better, something easier to use. It is called monitors. Instead of getting help from the OS, I will get help from the programming language. In other words, so operating system provides me these system calls like wait and signal, etc. But I will not use them directly. I will make the programming language use them for me. So it's a high level of abstraction for synchronization. Unfortunately, C doesn't support monitors, so you are stuck with your semaphores. But with Java language, you can use the monitor idea. So what the idea is the following. The compiler ensures that the critical region of your code are protected. You basically identify the critical sections with the language standards and put them into a monitor. And then the compiler adds up the protection code. Okay, the weights and signals. They are inserted by the compiler. So the compiler writer or the language developer needs to worry about this stuff, not you. Here is the example. Is an example. Just like a class construct, we use monitor. Okay, here. Inside of it, I have some shared variables, some functions, etc. And what monitor guarantees is that only one process or thread is active within these brackets at any given time. So by active, I mean if someone is executing P1, then another thread cannot be in Pn, because maybe if you allow that, something in Pn was updating shared variable, which will update P1. Okay, so it is dangerous. So once a thread is or process is inside a function of a monitor, then no other thread or process can come in. So let's go visual here. This is your monitor, and there will be a queue of the processes that want to come in. So this is the idea. But this solution is good for critical section handling, like mutex, mutual exclusion. But I also want to wait and block on other conditions, okay? Maybe I am solving dining philosopher problem or another producer-consumer problem or a resource allocation problem. So mutex is just not enough for me. I need other conditions that want some process to block. Okay, and that conditions are implemented using something called the condition variable. Okay, so I will now enforce a process to wait until a condition happens. So how do I do it? I will have two operations on a condition variable. So these are not semaphores, these are condition variables. X.wait, a process that invokes this operation is definitely suspended. And x.signal is like to resume one of the processes that has already invoked x.wait. So let's make the separation of a semaphore and a condition variable. With the semaphore, you may or may not block, right? If s is 0, you will block, but if s is 7, you will just make it 6 and continue. It will not block. But x.wait, you will definitely be blocked. where x is the condition variable. And also with s, you may have some integers like 6, 7 I mentioned. But with x, there is no integer. It is just the condition variable type. Okay. So now this is the addition. I have q's associated with each condition, x and y. So these are again processes waiting to enter to the monitor. If current active process wants to wait, for instance, there is an empty buffer condition, then it calls x.wait and added to the q of x and is no longer active. Okay, that is the logic. And then what happens? A new active process is in the monitor because I called x.wait, so it is now not in the monitor anymore. So a new active process is in the monitor obtained from the queue. So it does x.signal from a different or from the same procedure. It doesn't matter. And the when that active process does the x.signal, the one that was waiting on x will be awakened, will be unblocked. Okay, so previous process resumes from where it got blocked. But there is a problem. Now we may have two processes active. The one who has called x.signal, which is this new active process, and also the one who got waken up. Okay, so I have two processes, which is not okay by definition. So the solution is we put the x.signal as the last statement in the procedure so that the caller of x.signal will die anyway, because it is the end of that lifetime of that process. Or another solution can be you call x.wait right after x.signal to call to block the caller. So what do I mean here? You call x.wait after so the guy who has called x.signal has awakened another process, so you make him block. Okay, you block it. That is also another solution. But now let's solve some real world problems with the monitors as the last actions of today's class. Then it will be more clear. So let's put a monitor in action here. I have a monitor called allocate. This is about resource allocation. So I want to use this resource, a shared resource, so I need to be careful. And I have five instances, okay? So global variable is five. And there is no mutex here because this global variable will be protected by the monitor. And there is a condition. What is the condition? If I want to obtain this resource, so I call dot acquire, and if count is already 5 or 4 or 3 or 2 or 1, then I can get it. So I don't block and I just decrease count. So I am now here. So count became 4. Then count became 3, then 2, then 1. So I have only one resource. I still get that resource. So count becomes 0 now. So now here, 5 processes are here. Okay, count is 0. A sixth process comes. It wants to acquire, but count is 0. So it just blocks on C, on condition C. Maybe seventh process comes. It also blocks on condition C. So I have now two processes in the condition Q. Okay, C on in the Q of C. So what happens is when I call release, the first five guys, when one of them is done, it calls releases, the count becomes 1 again because it was 0 before and I just made it 1. And the more important part is I signal. So remember two processes were already waiting on me on C. So the same C now goes to the queue of itself and wakes some of the two up. Okay, so it will now escape from here, it will decrease count to zero again, because remember I made it one before, and now the sixth process is here, and so on. So let's solve the dining philosophers, okay, with the monitors. So let me first give you the big picture. I have this DP monitor, and I have this object of it called dining philosophers. So the ith philosopher wants to pick up the two forks. If it does it, then it starts eating, like using resources. And when it is done, it puts them back. Same guy, okay, I. And then goes to the thinking, doing nothing. So let's implement the pickup and put down now. First of all, I will be in this monitor, okay? Monitor. So I don't have to deal with mutex stuff. I will have this condition though. So when the process philosopher zero wants to eat, okay, so it wants to pick up. So my state is hungry, means I want to eat. So I will look at the fork zero and fork one, right? Sorry, not zero, for process zero. Do I have the picture here somewhere? So process philosopher zero is using fork zero and fork one. Okay, so I will look at the state of fork one. Okay, is it eating? No, good, so I can eat, but I also need the second fork to be non-eating. So the process zero will look at, so let me put that indexes actually, otherwise it will be a little complicated to follow. So I have this figure already, so let's follow it over that. Yes, okay, now let's be more clear now. So what did I say? So this is the fork zero, fork one, etc. But they are using for I, they look at index for one. In so according to this code, this is fork zero, okay? This is fork zero, this is fork one. Okay, no problem. So process philosopher one wants to eat, okay? So I is one, state one is hungry. I look at I look at fork two and sorry, these are not the forks, yeah, sorry, my bad. These are the these are the state of the processes, okay, the philosophers. So when the process, the philosopher one wants to eat, it will look at the state of the philosopher two, which is this, and also philosopher zero, which is one plus four is five, five mod five is zero. So it will look at state of two and zero. If they are not eating, and if I am hungry, which is definitely the case, so I will start eating, okay? And with since state is not eating, is eating, I am not going to wait. So this one is eating now, okay? But at the same time, if process two wants to pick up, so two will declare that it is hungry, but when two looks at the state of one, which is six mod five is one, it is eating, so it is false, so it will not convert it to eating, okay? And since state 2 is not eating, it will wait, okay? So condition 2 will wait, process 2 will wait. This is the idea. And when the process 1 finishes, it needs to put things down, right? So I will call put down with 1 parameter. So what happens here is I am state one is thinking now, I am not eating, okay. So I will update, I will maybe signal some of my neighbors. So for the one, the neighbors are 0 and 2, okay, 0 and 2. So 0 calls here, so be careful. Although I is 1 here, I call here with 0, okay. So, and for process 0, I look at my neighboring process, which is 1. And I also look at the neighboring process, which is 4. 0 plus 4 is 4. So they are not eating. Okay, wonderful. And I am also hungry. I was waiting. So I set it to eating. And also I signal, because 0 was waiting here before. Okay, so this is the mechanism. And here, these are just details how to access the neighbors using indices. So this is not related. So we fix that, handle that. And last example, again with the monitors, I will introduce you one little priority action. So remember what the when I wait on the condition variable, normally I just call wait, okay? But now I will give some priority. So it will affect the signaling. So what I mean by this is that you can enqueue the waiting processes with respect to a priority specified as a parameter to the wait call, okay? So what will be that parameter be? For instance, let's say that the process that will use the resource for the shortest amount of time will get the resource first. Okay, it makes sense because it will be over quickly. So now I want to do this prioritization. How can I do it? So let's go to an example here. Here is my resource allocator monitor. I want to use a resource for 10 minutes. For 30 minutes or for 25 minutes, okay? So assume that some other process or thread is already using it. So then what happens is the busy variable will be true if that single resource is already allocated, okay? So assume that thread 33 is already using that. So what happens is thread 33 has called acquire, and it is not busy because busy is false initially, okay? So, but 33 made busy true, okay? Busy is true now due to 33. And 33 is still using it, so it didn't call release. Now, for instance, thread 2 comes. Thread 2 wants to use it. So actually, let's go with this notation. Thread 1, 10, thread 2, 30. So let's, thread 2 wants to use it with 30 for 30 seconds. But the problem is, since this is busy, thread 2 will be in the waiting linked list of X. So I will put thread 2, but there is a priority. So with 30. So this is like the priority queue, mean heap maybe. Then later, 33 is still using it, and T1 came for the key of 10, okay, 10. So since it is also busy, it will T1 will go to the priority key. But normally, I will put T1 here, right? But now, I will use priority, which is 10 smaller than 30. So T1 will come here, and then T2. And let's also put T3 with 25. Okay, so maybe at some point T3 came. But 25, be careful, it is even better than this. So T3 will come between them. Okay, T3 with 25. And finally, this thing. So what happens is, when the 33 is done, it will call the release on it. So basically, it will call the same function after using. You will call the release for sure. The same code will be executed by many other threads. Okay, so what release does is the busy will be false now. Okay, in case someone comes. And more importantly, it will signal. So it will go to the head of the waiting queue, which is T1, definitely T1, because 10 is smaller than all of them. It will wake T1 up, not T3, not T2. So this is not random. This is not arbitrary. So you can also put that capability into your monitor. And with that, I will stop. This is the end of the synchronization business.